actually thinking about or using HBase in some type of production test. How many of you are actually on AWS or Cloud Platform? So it's a good intersection, usually kind of introduce myself. My name is Jeremy Carroll, so I'm an operations engineer at Interest. We're currently located in San Francisco, so it's a kind of nice drive in traffic down here. Thanks Eugene, everyone, for inviting me. I'm just here to talk a little bit about HBase and EC2. For those who are unaware, Interest operates entirely out of Amazon Web Services. We own no physical infrastructure, so when I started at Interest a little about a year and a quarter ago, they challenged us, the engineering organization, to not only run HBase to support some of the products that they've been developing, but do it on AWS. And when I went out to talk to other people about their experiences, many people haven't even done this. When I actually was talking with people like Andrew Bertel, he was like, I tried it once, wasn't a good story, didn't really work. You know, so part of our challenges was trying to figure out how to make it work, how to make it scale, how to make it performant. So I just want to kind of preface this talk that I want to kind of keep this informal. So if anybody has any questions and it's burning, just don't wait till the end, just raise your hand. I'll repeat the question so it gets on the video tape. And we'll kind of just have that informal dialogue, because as we like to figure that we got this pretty good operationally, not all of it is solved. So this is kind of just what we've experienced, one of our practices that we've been doing in production. So I just want to kind of give an overview of the talk. What I want to do is break this up in a couple of parts. The things that I wish I would have known before going on at Amazon Web Services and starting to install Hadoop. So the first thing was kind of deployment strategies for EC2. And what that means, when I talk to individuals wanting to run HBase on EC2, one of the first things they ask me is, what's the architecture? What does that look like? Where do you put your region servers? Which is instance size? All those type of questions that kind of come up. It happens in the co-location space, but in Amazon it gets a little bit more complicated. Second, once you actually deploy that stuff to the cloud, how do you validate what you have first? Because that's part of the fun about delivering new products and experiences on HBase, is if your first draft probably doesn't work, and then you have to figure it out and assume that's actually going to actually good product. And the third is, once you actually have something in production, how do you continue to support it? And the challenge is to kind of go to the interest.com, and you see something we call your home feed of all the things that you follow and the pins and people that you like. That's kind of this picture up here a little bit. That is actually powered by HBase. So all of the, anytime anybody logs in, we query HBase, get a list of all of their time-ordered IDs of all the pins and the things they followed, and render them in their timeline. The second thing is that we actually have an analytics products for business. So basically, if you want to get information, valuable insights about how your individual pins are doing, we have a business analytics product, which is kind of shown right here. And that actually back end is powered by HBase as well. We store all the statistics and the information on a per business account basis and render that. In addition to that, we have something we like to call rich pins, which are basically pins that have a lot more metadata about them, a lot more actionable. An example of that would be a recipe. So if you actually go on Pinterest and you see a recipe and you click on it, it'll have a lot more information about the recipe. It's kind of hard to see it on the screen for you. But you get like ingredients and things like that. All that metadata is actually stored in HBase. And then we actually crawl the information on the internet that can be enriched and then add that to that pin object. And then when we render that, we can actually render the additional attributes on that. So we have many different types of rich pins, from movies to recipe search to a bunch of different things. So, these are just some of the products that we actually support on Pinterest that are very user-facing. We have a lot of behind-the-scenes, non-visible things that are powered by that. I think right now, I think we have 6 or 7 different production-facing clusters for different products at Pinterest. So HBase is well-regarded as a first-class product in support. If somebody wants to launch a new feature on it, we have no qualms about giving them support in the launch service tonight. So usually when I talk to people, they're like, let's deploy. What's the first thing they say? They say, all right, I want to launch this on EC2. What are the instance types and instance size I need? How do I actually tune this to run? And I kind of go through a couple of them. So a little bit about Pinterest. We run kind of, this is just our experience. We run solid state clusters, which usually use the Hi-1-4XLs, which are solid state backed. We also use some of the newer C3 instances, which are both also solid state backed, because the cost per IOP on those really, really high IOP instances makes a lot of sense. If we actually have a lot of storage, but not as many IOPS, the kind of cost balance goes the other way, and we usually use m1.xlarge or vice versa, something with a lot more storage space, but not as many IOPS. So it really kind of becomes a balancing act on which one we use based on if it's really, really heavy read and write load versus not so much, but a ton of data. Like if we have one that's 80 billion rows and not too much, you know, read load or write load, then maybe we'll go for a SATA cluster versus a solid state cluster. In addition to that, there is some cloud concepts with Amazon Web Services that you have to be aware of. When you're in your own co-location facility, your own data center, you get total power to plan everything. You get to buy your top rack switches, you get to buy your racks and your rows and your hardware, and you get to make it exactly the way you want to. You don't necessarily have that choice with Amazon. Especially when it comes down to a high availability architecture, you can actually craft a rack locality script for your own data center that's really robust. And put, you know, the first block placement in one row, maybe the next one in a different room in that data center, maybe even the third in a totally different data center. You have that ability to do that. In Amazon, they only give you the construct of an availability zone to guarantee that your placement is actually physically sound. That means that if I'm in a region, such as US East 1, which is where Pinterest is located, and I have different availability zones available to me, if I want to guarantee that those blocks are not placed anywhere near each other for power loss or vice versa, I have to use the availability zone construct. They don't really let you see inside that black box that stays in the same room, same zone. And that's the magic of the cloud. You get unlimited capacity, we have no introspection other than the concept that you need to know that. In addition to that, there is certain things that come with the solid state groups called placement groups. So basically that allows you to do 10 gigabit full bisection bandwidth. And you get that with some of the more expensive solid state clusters. But that actually is a construct that kind of guarantees locality. Because when you talk to Amazon and they say you put launch instances into a placement group, they're going to be close. You don't know how close. You don't know if they're the same power supply, same rack, but you know they're close. Also, because of that, if you're actually crafting a high availability rack awareness strategy with that, you can kind of make some inference that if a placement group crashes and there's a problem physically in the data center, they may all crash, but you don't know that. So usually when I talk to people, they kind of have their ideas that they're going to do rack locality with availability zones and how that looks like. That's usually the first design I kind of get into. So if you guys can see this, this is kind of more of the one common design pattern that I see individuals using. So basically you have three availability zones, which is USDs like 1A, 1B, and 1C. And then most people want really, really legendary reliability. So I'll use something like the QJammer bookkeeper, the journal manager for high availability name node, and put two of those in two different availability zones. Then for the zookeeper ensemble for HBase to run, they put one, at least one in each availability zone for three total. And then they just start balancing the region servers, putting them all in each individual availability zone. And, that's a pretty rock solid design. I can lose one availability zone, hopefully you test it and do a game day exercise on that to actually prove your hypothesis to be correct. And it looks pretty good. When we were first starting on Pinterest, we were looking at some of this stuff, this design, because just because one, cluster one setup was really high available, we wanted them logically separate, air gap. So that it offers some other advantages. Like let's say, for example, we need to take a total cluster outage event. We do something like something major, like maybe take down the name node because of some fault or something like that. So we always wanted to run two so that we can have the ability to shut down one cluster and shunt traffic to the other cluster. So with that design, we'd actually have to run two. Two entirely logically separate and then keep them that way. And with the goal was that the way that our application works is that front-ending most of our HBase clusters is a pool of Thrift servers. That's how we communicate with HBase, it's always through Thrift, because we have Python clients, we have non-Java clients, all want to communicate with HBase. So all of our HBase clusters are front-ended by a pool of Thrift servers, depending on how much capacity, how much QPS load they actually get, queries per second, vice versa. So we actually have a system in Zookeeper that allows us to switch live on the fly where our traffic goes. So if we need to take one cluster down, we can actually modify the configuration and everybody just move to the second cluster, and then we can take that cluster down and do maintenance. So one of the nice things about us is that regardless of what edge of architecture we want, we always want two of them. But we looked at this in running in production, we thought that we could get it simple. So one thing that we wanted to do is to make this operationally simple. So one of the tenets that we always try to do inside reliability is make something really, really great, but then try to simplify it as much as possible to make it as bulletproof as possible. So we started taking a look at a different type of design. And the different type of design that we started looking at was, let's not try to get this thing super, uber reliable. Let's go ahead and put everything in one availability zone, let's call it like an HBase cell, and inside of a cell, since we don't really have multiple availability zones, it doesn't really make sense for us to invest in a highly available name node or vice versa at this exact time. And then let's just go ahead and run three, five zookeepers, whatever we want. And then as many region servers as required to actually support that cell, as we're kind of saying. The benefits of this is that it's incredibly simple, but it's not very reliable. A name node is a single point of failure, and it will crash. Also, Amazon has a great, we kind of joke internally that Amazon gives us a chaos monkey for free. It's called Amazon Web Services. So sometimes they'll send us little notices saying that your name node is going to be decommissioned in 14 days, and a really scary notice. And then you're like, oh God, no, now you gotta go ahead and switch this whole cluster over, or vice versa. But the benefits that we gain from that is that we gain a lot of simplicity. So when we launch instances, we have to choose what zone they are, and we know exactly which one they are. If we have placement groups because they're solid state clusters, then we just launch that placement group and we're okay. Operationally, repairing a zookeeper and name node for this is really simple. There's no form, general manager, utility user commands, or vice versa. Now, I'm not saying that we're not considering looking at some of those things. But at this exact point in time, it was easier for us to get operationally simple. But as HDFS 2.2 federated name node and everything else that comes out, we may take advantage of looking at those because sometimes the name node just needs some maintenance and it might be easier to not shuffle a whole cluster over and just take that one down. Questions?
Yeah. So zookeeper is the configuration management.
The zookeeper in this diagram is actually the zookeeper for the HBase setup. So that's the one that masters communicate to, the region servers communicate to, the one that does region assignment, or vice versa. The one that we have internally, we actually have different, Paxos installs for different products.
That's what are the products we have for the zookeeper? Can you talk about that later?
I can. I mean, at this point in time, we're just focused on the HBase. We have a lot of other uses that we do that kind of like. So the concepts of this stuff, just trying to focus on the HBase. So continuing on, the reason why we kind of like this architecture in general is because we run two. As I said, we always want to run two of something. So we kind of get a pseudo high availability name node in the fact that we actually run two clusters. It's not as good as the other diagram by a long shot. But from our automation perspective, we can automate this very easily. A lot of the code that we did with auto-scaling or Python or vice versa works pretty easy with this, and it's a lot more mentally easy to grasp. So for example, if a region server fails, with the model that I showed before, we had three availability zones, we have to make sure your capacity stays balanced. You can't just add one node and one availability zone, because then you're going to unbalance your stuff. You have to add one each. So that means that if you want to add capacity, you're going to add it in threes. You have three availability zones. Otherwise, you're going to unbalance your region distribution. And then for availability, if a cluster gets wounded, for example, and if you do a game day exercise on that, you better have the capacity to be also serve wounded. So you're going to lose 33% of your capacity off the top, and then you're going to be in a degraded mode that you're going to have to serve. So you have to be kind of a lot better about capacity planning. An example that when we actually tried the first wave, we forgot to tune the DFS bandwidth per second. And we set it as high as it possibly could go, which sounded great at the time because we had 10 gigabit networking in this one thing we're actually testing. But what we found is that when we actually lost an availability zone or quite a few region servers in one zone, the balancer bandwidth took over the cluster's I/O, and then the latency shot way past the rest of it. So pretty much when the cluster was wounded, it was down anyway. So at least with this kind of design, if one cluster is wounded, it's out. So if it's degraded in any way, we just switch over the other cluster, then we find the time to go ahead and repair that tool, hopefully in an automated fashion, and then get ourselves back on the cluster. That's the design we're kind of doing right now. But we're always willing to revisit it. Yes?
So you're designing, what throughput are you designing for? How many transactions per second for your redirect load and throughput in a second?
It's a good question. The question is what type of load are we actually designing for, read-write, throughput, and vice versa? We actually have a decision matrix at Pinterest that we try to make sure we're choosing the right persistent storage technology for the right question, for the right problem domain. We try to limit HBase's use case to things that have really, really high write amplification. We have a lot of other storage technologies with great success, sharded MySQL, sharded Redis, different types of storage pad technologies at Pinterest. HBase Excel is really good. We're using the LSM tree to its fullest. So for example, the one diagram I showed you with the home feed, that's a classic example where we have a huge write amplification. If one person pins something, and let's say they have 1,000 followers, that's going to create 1,000 bytes with our site.
So as you kind of notice, with a 1,000 time write application event for that one user, we get 90% more writes to that exact system. We get about 10%. So with that system, sometimes we've seen 2 million operations per second on that cluster, and most of it's a write to read loaded much, much more less than. But it all depends on the application. But those are the kind of things we try to do. If it's going to be low latency serving with a smaller data set, probably not going to get it. Yeah, for that one. We 99% less than 10 milliseconds. I have to, I don't know. I mean, my thing is that. Terabytes, not petabytes. But petabytes, I think, would be a different thing. So kind of going into the next thing, that's kind of general how we architect just the nuts and bolts of that for EC2. And then other things that we actually run HBase 94. 94.7 is what we run right now. We're experimenting with upgrading 94.15 for some certain bug fixes. One thing that we do is we have to qualify our releases, because since we actually stress test our servers much, much heavier than the average user of HBase, upgrades are non-trivial for us. There's little tiny corner cases that may pass a unit test or a simple integration test that won't be worn out by a lot of code. So we make sure that when we upgrade clusters, that we take time to upgrade and test cluster, try to do some phantom traffic to it, and so we're a little far behind with there. We don't have plans right now to go to 96, which is the newest version, but it's something we don't want to get straight too far for the community from, but at this time, we're just taking that 94. Question?
Yeah, are you guys doing active-active or active-passive? Master, master, master.
Fantastic question. The question was that our setup, we're trying to do active-active or active-master or passive or vice versa. The current setup that we do is actually active-passive. The reason why is because it's a little easier for us to support that load, and we're not as concerned about wasting the money. We would actually find it a little bit simpler to actually support active-passive, but that is a muscle that is only good when it's exercised. So we switch actually clusters quite often. Just do that. For example, if I want to do optimization on one cluster, I want to do a major compaction event that's going to, impact latency, and it's going to be really long and drawn out, and I didn't have the capacity on that cluster to actually do it while online serving, we'll just switch the cluster over, perform those maintenance operations, switching back. So unlike the traditional hot cold, I kind of call it kind of hot warm, because we actually do that quite well. If we didn't do that often, I would be a little more risk averse to see it's actually going to work when we switch over. But since we do that, frequently, it works pretty well for us. Yes, question.
So what kind of cluster do you measure for the in-house or cluster management?
Sure, great. The question is, what type of cluster management tools that we use? Is it in-house or is it somebody else? It's a very great question. When we actually looked at deploying HBase, we wanted to stay on trunk. So the reason being is that a lot of redistributions of Hadoop, your favorite one, I think they're all beautiful. The other ones have their favorite ones or whatever. I do as well. But we actually rebundle HBase trunk ourselves, and we package it for ourselves, and we deploy it ourselves. Mainly because we keep tighter to what's available in the community than a company like Hortonworks or Cloudera. You know, they figure more stability than they actually do.
So in other words, we don't use any
The reason why we use our own internal tools, because we actually manage HBase like our other persistent storage technologies app interest. We have our own very opinionated ways internally how we manage it, what tools we use. Therefore, a lot of the things that actually a company would offer us from a cluster management solution doesn't fit within our SRE mentality. So from us, it's a lot better for us to manage and maintain that cluster with our internal tools and internal processes. Just because it's just the way that we do everything. We just don't want any kind of like you have to go to whatever cluster management utility provided by a third party. If we want to add additional capacities or hook it into our internal infrastructure, we may or may not have access to that source code. So the next thing is that once you actually get something out there, an actual HBase cluster going, we have a lot of new product development. As I kind of said before, at Pinterest, a lot of people are actually using HBase for new products. We're developing new things all the time. We're launching new clusters to support new services. So how do we actually validate things like schema design, load testing, so that we actually go production with a feature? It's a non-event. The last thing that we actually want is that when we actually turn on a new feature to the public that's actually powered by one of our storage technologies like HBase, is for us to not know how it's going to handle that. So basically, just trying to talk about the methodology about how you actually develop and you know, your solution on HBase and how do we validate that it's correct and it's actually going to work. So one thing that we've actually did is, I talked about this a little bit at HBaseCon last year, is we developed a lot of individual internal tools and scripts to help us kind of validate a schema. So one thing that the more common issues that we usually see, just kind of taking a step back that we see when people design things for HBase, is we usually see poor distribution of data where you know they had a wrong idea of what that was going to be, and there's only one region server doing the majority of the work. And that can manifest itself in a couple of ways. It manifests itself as a hot region where the requests, like the data is even distributed, but the requests are all going to one region server. Or it can be the actual data is lopsided, where you actually have one region server that has maybe 70 gigabytes for the store files, and everything else has 10 megabytes. You know, those are the things that we kind of see in production. And the reason why that's important is that I can't add capacity to an HBase cluster if I can't add capacity and have it evenly distributed. So if I can't split my work up, kind of like Hadoop, if I can't split my inputs, can't take advantage of more amount of tasks, or can't take advantage of more parallelism. So one thing that we want to make sure is that if we do that, how do we actually farm out a load where we add an additional region server, maybe split some regions and get additional capacity in some time. So I just showed some graphs. We open sourced some tools that we want to do more of this. We developed a lot of R visualization scripts and tools that we can actually take snapshots of HBase tables, HBase clusters, and see, you know, kind of in general, actually I have to work in about how they look. So this was one bottom one right here is basically just a distribution of store files. So in store file size. So basically it showed kind of like a bimodal distribution of data. So one person had their key design where a ton of it was right here in the middle, you know, kind of like a histogram layout, a little bit was on the end. These things in the end, terrible time. They never get any requests, they're pretty much idle. So if you actually went to production with that, it'd be a pretty interesting thing to scale. It'd be pretty challenging. Another thing that we wanted to do is kind of just look at, in general, a cluster. So how do we know how many things we put on one cluster? How much data, how we've got load balancing. And this isn't just all the story, this is just some visualization techniques that we use to kind of say, display them. And I think looking at data distribution is one of the easiest ways to kind of to think about the problem, mainly for the fact that the majority of the time that I was spending actually supporting production workload cases, it usually comes down to some unforeseen events. An example would be somebody can have a really nice fair distribution of data with an MD5, you know, type of topology, but they didn't, you know, plan for humans. And that's what happens when actually they're in production. Like for example, if there's a really popular user and you don't have any memcache or anything else like that in front of the system, and that person's really, really popular, you have the best data distribution in the world, that region server is going to be really, really high. You know, then there are actually other techniques to try to cache that, try to get those requests off the HBase so they can keep storing over and over and over again. So it's kind of one of those things that is a little bit of a dark arts, just one of those things. Another thing that I wanted to talk about in general is compaction. So when I was talking to some of the other colleagues that run HBase clusters, there's kind of a, you know, like almost like a proverb that you can only take as much data as you can actually compact. So when you're tuning these clusters for workloads, you have to make sure that you can actually serve low latency online traffic and then still keep up with your write load to make sure the compactions keep the store files low. An example would be is that if you don't have enough I/O capacity for a cluster, let's say you undersized it, you didn't know what you had. You'll start seeing latency get really, really bad because there's a lot of store files. You're like, well, why is there a lot of store files? Well, you look at your write load, and you're seeing that, hey, there's a lot of writes coming in, and it's taking a long time to compact. You're like, well, why is it taking a long time to compact? You look at the disk realization or I/O capacity on the system, and you realize you don't have enough I/Os to actually compact that and serve at the same time. So you kind of get in this catch-22 where you're continuing to pile on writes, and then your reads are getting slow, and then your customers are happy because you just blew the SLA on the cluster. And then nobody's happy because the system just basically ate itself. And I think that is more common for most people when they start to use HBase. They start to see that because they use something like Hadoop to populate it, which basically everyone knows Hadoop is a great sledgehammer. It's going to come in as fast as it possibly can. So one thing that we always try to do is to make sure that we're tuning compaction, that we can keep up the low latency online reads by keeping the store files low and to make sure that our compaction strategy can handle the writes. Now that sounds all fine and dandy. Now how do you do it? It's based on, I've never seen a generic thing. The generics out there, the base tunables are really good. If you don't have a problem, I would say you probably don't have to mess with that stuff. Going into the compaction code and looking how to tune it is pretty scary. But I was saying that some of the tools that we actually use to determine when we need to do that, there's a company called Centric that made a tool called Hannibal, which is really great. looks at log files, looks at compaction time, has a lot of visualization techniques. We do some stuff with a good old-fashioned log file analysis, which you probably can't read from that far away. And then some visualization techniques to know how fast our mem store is filling, when flushes happen, which is that, the store files go up, and then how long the amount of time that takes. An anecdote that I'll actually give about that is like, when you have a high write load, and as I said before, we try to put things with lots and lots of writes instead of HBase, you have to tune, most people kind of figure this out when they actually go through it, you have to tune your H logs as well. So for example, the default out of the box is you get, I think, 32 times 64 megabytes worth of H logs, and I think that's about 2 gigabytes worth of heap size. So if you set your mem store size where you can actually take 5 gigabytes worth of stuff before you have to flush, and you don't tune that variable, you'll get capped out at 2 gigabytes. So you have to tune all these things kind of in flight to each other. An example that we actually saw at Pinterest was somebody just spawned a default cluster, didn't tune that variable, and they're telling us, why does all my stuff just stop for a while, and then I've seen the logs, too many H logs forcing flush, and they flush all the regions all at the exact same time. And they had pretty large clusters, so they flushed 400 regions at the exact same time, created that ton of store files, all of this had to be compacted. They didn't have enough I/O capacity to do that, so they were like, well, I just kind of went along, and all of a sudden, boom, and the latency got terrible, the thing just went off the rails, and just recovered a little while later. So my thing is that some of the techniques that we do is we always make sure that we're giving visualization techniques and cluster management tools, kind of the gentleman's question, so people can kind of figure out ex post facto what happened, but usually we try to do these type of things ahead of time. So one of the techniques that we do is before we launch a new product or service, we have an ability to do phantom reads and phantom writes, which is a fantastic capability. If your software application stack does not support them, I'd say that's probably one of your best friends while developing for HBase. An example of that would be, if you need to redo your schema design or key distribution design, having a tool like Hadoop to redo your input splits, maybe do a total order partitioner offline, then bulk load those H files in so you can keep playing, experimenting with it. HBase kind of reminds me a little bit of Lucene, if anybody's ever played with Lucene. Usually everyone does their schema, and then you do it again, and again, and again, because you're not going to get it right the first time. So usually having an ability to regenerate your data experience. In addition to that, when I said when we launch a product feature, we don't want it to be a surprise when it actually goes live. So a lot of our stuff, our website's asynchronous. We don't try to do everything synchronous in line with users' requests. So because of that, we have a queuing system behind the scene, which actually has the ability for us to duplicate or fork those requests. So we can actually say, oh, I'm going to put 30% load for this new product feature on the system. So we can say, great. So all 30% of these actions will get duplicated and be replayed against the other system, which has been fantastic for us to know what our load pattern is, to know what our testing looks like, and it actually look like real-world production code. Because once we actually go into production, the same system will be doing the exact same thing top to bottom, which is really nice for us. There's not something in QA or development. It doesn't look anything like production, and then you find a lot of surprises when you go to launch. But I think that's actually what you guys can do. Yes, question? That's a good question. The question was that if we have a schema change, how do you read all your data? And that's good, because I would have to ask ourselves that from time to time. It depends. Some of our clusters actually, one thing we like about HBase is that it marries really, really well with Hadoop. So a lot of our Hadoop workflows that actually create artifacts, we'll create H files, and then move those across the wire and bulk load. So with those type of clusters, we have a cluster, one of the products I didn't mention up front was one that says things that you may have also bought. So if somebody pins something, we'll actually show them other types of pins that they may like based on machine learning and other types of techniques. And that's served by HBase, but that's an artifact generated only every once in a while, so it can be bulk loaded. So in that case, super simple. Just go back to Hadoop, spend the money and the time, regenerate the H files with a new split if you want, just CP them over, bulk load them in, you're good to go. Other types of data that an example would be the EAT system. That stuff is a little bit more complex because that is real time and vice versa. Now, I don't think there's a general answer for that can help a lot of people out here. I think that generally you have to architect your systems to do that. We have one system internally that allows us to do a time order stream of events, kind of like go back in time and get a time order event stream. So that actually helps us a lot replay things, if you understand. So if we actually change the schema, we can go grab the stuff out of our backup cluster if we wanted to, redo that table, then go to a period in time and then replay that against the new schema or vice versa. Or we can do other types of events and tips where we just create a new table and then we just promote the code to actually write to the new table. There's a lot of different ways you can do that. I really think it's architecture dependent. In general, it's good to start thinking about those things as you design your application. And if it's their first kind of foray out the gate with HBase, I would say having that do not absolute source of truth for your data will probably ensure success. Because if it goes down or something happens, the recoverability is still one. Okay, so the question was the dual break capability. Now, this is, I think, something specific to us. We had a system, we don't want to use this one, but we had a system based on GitHub's rescue, and there was a version of Python called PyRes. So for a long period of time, we had a forked version of PyRes, which we contributed the patches back up to the community, that handled almost all the asynchronous tasks for our website. So as tasks came in, they went into a Redis, you know, clustered Redis queue, and then those things have retries act, and then if it fails, retry, replay. Or if we actually want to have two clusters and not have HBase replication, that could actually kind of do a two-phase commit if your key's right, it's open, you understand? We can kind of use that to kind of do what we're trying to do. But I think that's based on everyone's architecture. Cool. So I'll just talk real quick about one tool that's been kind of invaluable for us as we're evaluating HBase clusters and going to production, which has been OpenCSP. So the one issue that we had from an operations perspective, and I'm going to put my operations hat on and take my engineering hat off for a little bit, getting visibility into HBase is incredibly challenging. Any tools that actually make it easier are just unbelievable when it comes to supporting production. One issue that we had initially is that there's a ton of data inside of HBase about regions, but the ability for a monitoring system to handle it is hit or miss based on the type of product you use. And I'll tell a little bit of an anecdote. We were actually using graphite at the time to do all the rendering of this data. And if you're not familiar with graphite, it's a time series database written in a unit called Carbon. And every metric point that you get makes a pre-allocated time series database on a disk. That means for every unique data point, creates a file. And that file would be zeroed out or nulled out or vice versa, based on your retention period. So when we enable per region server statistics and per region statistics, some of our tables had 1,800 regions or vice versa. That's 1,800 data points on disk. Now if we split it, that data then will never be written to again, but we still have to store it on disk. The scalability of the system was really, really tense. This data is really hard, really high cardinality, really a lot of uniqueness, and that system just didn't like that. Didn't like having regions exist for one day and then not exist the next day. So scaling the system was a little bit challenging. One thing that was nice about OpenTSDB is that you get, I think it's like 1 or 2 bytes per data point, depending on the way it is. And it's ephemeral in nature because of the way it stores it. So if you store the region server for a little bit of time, it only takes as much bytes as it actually was alive. So storing this, scaling the system was incredibly easy from that perspective. We wrote in the open source some code for HBase. If you're not familiar with OpenTSDB, they have a daemon called tcollector, which will collect statistics on an interval and send them to OpenTSDB. So we wrote one in Python that will capture a myriad of region server statistics at really, really high intervals. So like every 10 seconds, every 60 seconds, or whatever we wanted to. And the nice thing about it is that it has a lot of information. So for example, it allows us read requests, write requests, number of store files compactions on a per region basis, on a per table basis, and on a per region server basis, and even a per cluster basis. So there's a lot of multi-dimensional aggregation capabilities, which is really, really nice for slicing and dicing your cluster. So an example was that, sorry, I can't read this as a contrast, but I'll put the slides up afterwards so you can see this. But basically, we had one graph on the left which showed the distribution of one table. So what was the read request rate on a per table basis? So this one HBase cluster had like 3 or 4 tables. There's the load on read request rate. And then we said, okay, well, this one system right here, this one table, what is the region? So we want to see if we have a hot region, that's what we want to know. So we just go ahead and put a little star in the region and a little UI right there. And then lo and behold, we get read and write request rate per region. Looks great, because it's all very uniform. This was an MD5, some key distribution, so that wasn't a surprise. And then if we want to even go even further on a per region basis, per table basis, per cluster, per table, and even per region basis, you can keep slicing and dicing and go as deep as you want. Which that is the capability that we use all the time when it comes down to we actually render our graphs and charts from this data. So when we actually show some of those things, we actually just go grab the data out of OpenTSDB and then pipe it through R and then analyze it in a time series fashion. Or we actually go through this tool ad hoc to go for it. The one major complaint is this UI they give you out of the box is not very sexy. So the peers out there might not like it. I personally believe that if it gives me insight, I don't care what it looks like. It can be a 1980s bitmap, it can be a Nintendo, or I don't care. As long as it gives me insight on it. So So next I want to talk about is going to production. So once you actually develop a cluster and it's already out there, I think some of our oldest clusters been in production at Pinterest almost a year now, which has been really good continuous operability. I think Jay Krebs was talking about hours of uninterrupted operability, and HBase has been doing pretty good things from an SLA perspective. But what do we actually have to do to actually support something once it's launched? So great, you got your product out there, it went great, you did dark reads and writes, the load is great, but how do you actually maintain that system? Because when you have it day one, and when it looks like day 364, maybe entirely different. It requires care and feeding, capacity planning, that sort of thing. You can't just say I'm done and walk away. I don't think there's anything that actually doesn't care. So just a little bit talking about how we do alerting, monitoring, health detection on the system. So this was a UI that we developed internally based on OpenCSPD data because of the complaints of a lot of people that they just didn't want to look at the dashboard like that. But at least the one thing about this one we developed internally is it is powered by D3, so it allows a lot more interactive dynamic stuff. You can actually hover over and determine what system was on. The one issue with OpenCSPD was if you have a, let's say you have 1,000 regions, and you have to draw 1,000 lines, well, there's no way you're going to be able to read the legend. So at least with something like this, we can actually do that. So one thing that we kind of do is a general gauge of overall health of the human's consumption is we have an overall cluster dashboard that anybody can go to that has the status of all of our clusters. So usually when I say that we measure the health of HBase, we try to make sure we keep the metrics really valuable, top-level metrics. We want to know what's your SLA, like what's your latency that you're going to tolerate. Your cluster has to have like 99.9% less than 10 milliseconds or 50 milliseconds latency, and it has to have this many errors per second or less, or throughput or bandwidth or vice versa. So we try to do the business metrics up front. So those are what really matter. There's a million metrics on HDFS, there's a million metrics on HBase. Looking at all of those in a dashboard, your high-level dashboard, it's probably not going to give you a lot of business value. To try to keep it at a really, really high level, how is the system performing? And a lot of the things that is in HBase right now with our version of 94, there's not a lot of metrics that actually tell you end-to-end, from somebody coming to the RPC, to getting service, to coming back out, the end-to-end response time of that system. So a lot of the measurement that we do isn't the best, but we do it from our thrift layer, and that gives us a little bit more picture. Now, it actually fudges the numbers because of maybe it's the thrift server latency, maybe it's the network or vice versa, but at least that will, from that perspective, tell us a lot of the latency we're in. This one overview is a little bit of the thrift latency or vice versa, but you can also get into the ones they give you is the disk latency. They give you like FSP read for random read latency, other sequential latency inside of HBase. But that's just how much disk time it was, but if it was served out of the mStore or there's some other issues in the RPC queue that won't manifest themselves there, so it's not really good storage for end-to-end response time inside of HBase. Question? The question is if the cluster is scalable and what's the latency?
Yeah, well,
auto scale?
Yes, what is the
I would kind of say their auto scale thing isn't really for performance though. Because for example, if we actually.
Latency,
that's a good question.
That's a good question.
The question was around latency and auto scaling. So when you add capacity to an HBase cluster, you're not going to exactly get it because it has no data.
On AWS, right?
On AWS, right. Or actually, even if you're in the colocation facility, when you add a different, like a brand new data node HDFS, it has no blocks. So if everything's going to be across the network read. So if you were suffering from IO capacity, you'd be sunk. You know, like you had additional capacity, you actually see a drain on that. As new data comes through and gets written to that region server and it creates store files and can pass, it will additionally, over time, depending on your write rate or fill rate, add capacity to that cluster. But if you're already in trouble, adding additional node is not going to immediately give you capacity. So I think that the scaling for us is to maintain a steady state. Hopefully we actually look at our metrics and forecast a little bit so we don't get in that situation where we actually have to add capacity and under duress or anything like that.
So you only do scale up.
Yeah, I mean, the question is, do we only scale out or we scale down? And actually, the answer is we never scale down. Scaling down HDFS is incredibly tricky from the block location, block locality, also from the availability. You know, how do we decommission takes a long time. So normally, I don't think we've ever auto scaled down a cluster. We've always added down.
I'm talking about scaling out. Mm-hmm. Now, when we mention scale up or scale down, that means without change, topology of the cluster.
Okay.
Instead of, you know, to replace your current node with more powerful
CPU
or more memory, whatever.
Okay, I understand. So the question was more around philosophical vertical scaling versus horizontal scaling. Do we replace with more powerful instances, or do we add more to actually gain scale? And that's a good question. One thing that we have been doing is Amazon actually releases different instance types all the time. They recently released the C3 series, which is actually a solid state, which is 180 gigabytes worth of solid state on a very cheap node with a lot of CPU, which makes it kind of great for actually OpenTSD clusters running that exact instance type. So if there's a new SKU kind of vertical scale, kind of to actually say that actually is more powerful, we can play around with that by either A, creating a new cluster, and that's what we did in the case of OpenTSDB being anecdotal. We actually crafted a new cluster, copied the data off of that onto a new one, and then backfill the data and switch them. That's kind of how we did a vertical replacement, kind of did a side-by-side. And the next thing about having the cloud or Amazon Web Services is that we don't need to ask our finance department for CapEx to go spend another $1 million to get another side-by-side cluster just so I can upgrade. That's one thing that's really nice about the elasticity of the cloud is that for temporarily, I can spawn a totally new cluster, get as many nodes as I actually need to facilitate that transfer, and then get rid of them so that they reduce my overhead.
So what kind of problem that you are solving? I'm just curious about your
Is that a computer intensive
or memory intensive approach?
The question was around the use case of HBase. At Pinterest specifically, HBase is a low latency online scalable data store. That's our answer. There's a lot of other people who use that for other types of MapReduce jobs or vice versa. We do that in some cases, but at this time, it's almost like MySQL other type of storage systems online.
Question.
Yes, question.
So,
another
entry, it's a KV store. In your case, what is the size of the value and the nature of the data type of the value?
It's a good question. The question was around our key value store in HBase, what's the typical size of the key in the line? It all depends. Some things may be as generic as a key value zero like JSON one, you know, where that might be very 3 kilobytes, 1 kilobyte, or so. Some other times it's actually more structured data. An example of the feed system, Varun, one of the colleagues, did a talk about actually how we structure that system. And that is very low amounts of data. It's primary key value from user ID to other front ID to pin ID. So a very, very small amount of data. It all depends on the use case on how much data. The cell, we try to keep it smaller than that, but we have some things that actually have that. But it all depends. Yeah, that's actually the largest, I think, that we've actually got. I mean, most of them are a lot, lot smaller. So I mean, I'm just showing a little bit of overview of the dashboard. But in general, the kind of things that we measure, I kind of said like the $5 metrics, the overall latency, the health of the system, errors per second, bandwidth, all those nice things to have. So we kind of call those baselines. Those are table stakes. We don't launch a cluster at Pinterest that we don't have those type of metrics. If we don't have an SLA next to your cluster, then how are we going to measure and make sure that you're meeting your SLA? We need to find one. What's those guidelines? Are we looking at errors, like for error rate, CPU vice versa, to detect outliers? And the nice thing about some of the applied visualization techniques that you can use, the good old-fashioned line graph. You got like this one cluster, read requests, lots of region servers, so you can kind of get a general idea. But you can kind of start seeing there's some things that are a little bit higher than others, so you know maybe you want to investigate that, maybe there's a little bit of distribution. But you know what? You can look at that till you're blue in the face. If your SLA is being met and you have no problems, well, it's not necessarily pants on fire. Another thing that we actually have is user CPU. Do we detect outliers? And this is great because there's a lot of developers at Pinterest that will use different types of ways to query the data, which may or may not be something that we generally recommend. There's a lot of people learning on HBase. An example, an anecdotal example, is we actually saw a test cluster that had one region server that was going crazy with CPU load. And we're just wondering what that was. So we profiled it and found out the person was using a just atrocious regex scanner, you know, with a lot of data, really, really deep scanner, vice versa, hitting on one region server makes it really hot. So this is the type of thing that we kind of try to get by looking at the distribution of user CPU. And in this case, the name node on the cluster really low, and the name node should be that's high other problem. Another thing we do is kind of like distribution of scatter plots of data to see outliers and outlier bands to see what the latency is. So this one's like 99 percentile. I don't know, it's usually five milliseconds, but there's one way to do that there. So you try to keep up with it. So I'm trying to talk a little bit about visualization techniques. So some of the tools that we actually use from an operations perspective, keeping my operations hat on, work really, really well, but they fall down when you have a lot of servers in that cluster. didn't have to have a lot of servers. You draw a lot of lines, it's kind of hard to just look at that. So I kind of just put a little example out there that having statistical data analysis frameworks like R, you know, I love it because you can play with the data and just do different visualization techniques without having to write a brand new web tier. Like, for example, if I'm going to draw a heat map in R and I want to get an answer, it's going to take me a little bit of time to investigate the framework, come up with really pretty JavaScript, and do all my jQuery magic or vice versa. Whereas if I just want an answer, I can literally just go into R, slice and dice this data, and get a heat map. So I think it's more valuable that if we're going to do this all the time, maybe we'll invest in the online web tool, but you can just go at it. So for example, this one was one cluster that we actually saw, just kind of, you see the day-night pattern of distribution requests. You know, we're a social media company. I think most other type of companies have that same type of pattern where they have a, you know, day-night pattern as users come on, go on, and vice versa. So we kind of see that natural arc, but then we kind of see that, you know, here it's kind of hard to see, like, what the bands look like, and you say, hey, there's actually kind of like a bimodal distribution of these bands. And it's kind of hard to see because there's so many lines. We do the exact same data down here, and I don't know if the contrast can actually show this good. But we kind of see some, you know, things show up. So for example, this is our lighter, darker day-night pattern here. What we see, like, these really weird lighter bands of servers, and each one of these lines is a server. I kind of hid that because I don't think you guys really used to server names. But you kind of see there's some interesting things going on there. And when we actually looked at this cluster, we actually found out that there was some data skew on this one, that these servers just had more things to serve. And this was a pretty evenly distributed cluster, so since they had more data to serve and it was pretty fair, they were hotter. And some times of the day, because humans are humans, they were hotter than other times. So I kind of just wanted to show what are some of the things we've kind of seen in production. Everyone likes a good war story. I don't like to kind of go into the disaster, you know, stories and vice versa, but just hopefully they don't have to this publicly. when the clusters are still there. But you know, I kind of want to show one issue that we kind of did and how we triaged it and kind of how we supported this in production. So we saw, we said the high-level metrics, the overview, the SLA started going to crap on this cluster. So the latency was normally very, very good, normally less than, like, what I said before, 5-10 milliseconds. All of a sudden, really weird what shoots up, you know, going up to 80 milliseconds, 90 milliseconds. RPC queue, you know, requests are skyrocketing on this cluster. The amount of time RPC spent in the queue versus processing all starts going really weird. So we start getting alerted to this cluster and test just because it wasn't performing. And then we go to the other type of things when we look at cluster health. We found that the second diagram here, one of those region servers had a really hot CPU. So on the right-hand side, we had CPU 0 to 100, and then that little red line was CPU. And then no wonder why that system wasn't performing very well. It's 100% CPU, and the entire time it was experiencing latency. And then we coordinated that with the overall latency of that system with the green line. So yeah, I went 150 milliseconds latency, 200 milliseconds latency, so immediately there. Then we went ahead into the server and we started profiling the job they keep on the fly. So we used some, the one that's using this thing is hot threads. There's many ways you can actually get a thread dump to actually see where CPU time is spent, hopefully without hooking up an agent or a front end time to profile. So we actually found out in this one, there was a certain type of class, a key value comparator. So HBase does take memory to compare key values. This specific one had a really nasty corner case where a spammer was on the site. A spammer in this thing loaded up this region on key values and made it really, really deep in its key store. And when the scanner did that, it had to skip over all that stuff. It had to evaluate it to go over to really, really deep scanning. So then it actually manifested itself as that kind of latency. The solutions for that were, A, bound your stuff. Don't let somebody scan everything, or vice versa. And then go ahead and, you know, figure out distribution patterns and things like that to kind of prevent that. So in general, my general methodology is we start off at a high level, and we always end up looking at logs. You know, we never end up have something that's going to tell us the oracle or the answer. We just keep going back to that later and go through and collect them. So I just want to talk really quick about alerting. At Pinterest right now, driving all the alerting for our HBase clusters is a product called Sensu. Sensu is a monitoring framework that was developed to work with the cloud in mind. It handles auto-scaling and ephemeral nodes in and out. You can use whatever, you know, monitoring leadership that you have. The next thing that we do is we put a runbook on our stuff so that when things go wrong, hopefully you don't have to wake me up. Hopefully there's a nice step-by-step guide that you can do at 2 o'clock in the morning so I can get my duty sleep. So I try to keep it that way. Additionally, we measure the kind of high-level overview metrics, region service, live, dead. You know, I'm saying that the more type of actionable stuff that we know exactly how to fix on something. we get latency events or vice versa. Chrome and I can get cover run book. It's going to say how do you debug your code. You can't read any of that, but basically, and I'll just watch that. Sorry about that. But also, how do you do backups? So this is one thing that I would love the community to start looking a lot more on. There's been a lot of really, really great work from the community. People with Salesforce or vice versa on snapshots. We utilize snapshots quite a bit. Basically, what our idea is that we go ahead and snapshot the tables with the online snapshot utility. Then we export those tables and export snapshot stuff with our own Java code so we can copy it out to a different cluster. The thing is that I said we always have two clusters, so we always use the backup cluster to take our backups on, which is natural. So we don't impact latency, low latency serving because we take all the backups on. Since we're on the cloud and on Amazon, we experimented with copying directly to S3 and it didn't work out too well. S3 has a lot of little individual corner cases that fail jobs. It sometimes is not as performant and takes a really, really long time. Also, from our perspective of mean time to recovery, we did not want to rely on S3's ability to serve our data as part of our strategy to get clusters bootstrapped up. So it ultimately came down to is we had started running our own HDFS clusters. So we started running HDFS, high available HDFS inside of Amazon. Started using it as a staging area for our backups. So we take snapshots, we copy them over to the HDFS staging area, and if we need to recover those backups, we actually use that staging area to CP them off or vice versa. For a long time strategy, considering I can only have so much space for local backups, we will then take our time and then go and S3 DCP those up from that backup cluster to S3. Now, it's something we're still experimenting with. We actually have projects this quarter and on a roadmap to experiment to make that easier because it's actually relatively complex and involved. One thing that we actually we ended up in a lot of corner cases, there's a lot of little tiny bugs that happen with snapshots that are resolved, I think 0.94.11. Covered most of the little tiny things that happen with snapshot backup support. It's a fantastic ability because we don't have to disable the table, keep it offline for long periods of time to get that data on before you have to disable the table, disable writes, disable everything, and make sure that it's consistent, flushed, and then copied off. So it's great work. It's just that it's a little bit involved. I don't think a lot of people appreciate it. Also, the recoverability story. So once you actually get your data recovered from snapshot, we kind of treat that as our full backup. So in traditional backupisms, you got your full backups and your incrementals, and then if you use other type of systems like MySQL, you have your write-ahead log and you can replay that. There's not a lot of tools like that for HBase specifically right now. We get full backups, but how do we recover stuff in between those full backups? Do we get H logs or walls, in the system and replay them? There's not a lot of tools out there or know-how for that. So right now we're kind of filling in our own internal tools as a way to recover that data between full backups. But from a community perspective, I think there's some work to be done to make that issue get rid of some other type of fixes in place.
How do you deal with
the
same
server?
Like,
we can do any. So for example, in the event that we actually had a crash, let's say we had a name node start on fire. The entire cluster went down, we had a total data loss. We would have to spawn up a new HBase cluster and then populate those backup tables. So then we end up DCPing that data back and then importing the snapshot and recovering the tables. And then we have to get that data back up to date with what has changed since it crashed. I mean, we have the time to type up the backup, so we know consistent to that period in time. We still have to recover from now to then from the cluster to get it back up to service to get our. Because if you realize the amount of time it takes to get that cluster back up to full strength is risk. So we want that time to be small. Question? Yes. The question is during the business day, do we have peak and off-peak time? I would say we have times a day that are more busier than others based on the day-night activities of our users. But you can call that peak. But technically, we're always on. It can never be done.
So yes.
My question was more on how to scale and cost production.
Yeah.
It's not a goal for us. We want to maintain low latency online serving with fantastic. Yep, go for it. I want my persistent. I don't want to scale down my persistent stores to save a buck. I want to be online. I want to be on time. I want to be fast. I want to be mobile. How do you figure out the size of your cluster was the question. We did that through phantom reads, dark reads, and load testing before we came. But pretty much that's the conclusion of my talk. Thanks. Also, as it comes down to every other company in the Bay Area, we are hiring viciously and vigorously for any type of challenges that you think is exciting. Question?